We're going to start with Richard. Richard, as we begin this dialogue, where we live and where we learn, how should we address the effects of residential segregation by race and class on American schools?
Thank you. In 1954, when
when the Supreme Court handed down its decision that the jury segregation of schools was not constitutional, Thurgood Marshall, who was the NAACP lawyer who handled the case, who led the team that handled the case, held a press conference when the decision came out. And he said that, in the press conference, he said, "Now that we've desegregated schools, we're going to turn our attention to desegregation of housing." And the NAACP Legal Defense Fund never did, because there was such massive resistance to the school desegregation decision that its lawyers were consumed for the next 20 years trying to defend the school desegregation decision, and they never got to turn their attention to housing. In retrospect, the NAACP would have been better off pursuing housing first rather than schools, because had they pursued housing desegregation and had we made any impact on the segregation of our metropolitan areas in this country, school integration would have followed, because the primary reason, as you all know, that schools remain segregated is not because now we have laws assigning white students to some schools and black students to others, but because they're in segregated neighborhoods. And those neighborhoods are segregated to such an extent that while there are some small cities and borderline areas where you can accomplish some modest integration with busing plans and magnet schools and choice systems, most African-American children in this country, in urban areas, live too far distant from white middle-class suburbs, even if they could, with busing, come to some inner ring working-class suburbs. They're too far distant from white middle-class suburbs for any meaningful and practical integration plan to proceed. We have not approached housing desegregation. We have a fair housing law now, which prohibits future discrimination, ongoing discrimination in housing. But the fair housing law has done nothing to remedy the unconstitutional segregation of residential areas that was carried out by the federal, state, and local governments throughout the 20th century. And one of the reasons, and probably a precondition, one of the reasons that we have not addressed that is because we are consumed by a national myth. And this myth is not just the myth that's held by conservatives, it's not just the myth that's held by racists, it's a myth that's held across the political spectrum from right to left, and that is that what we experience in residential areas is de facto segregation. We have de facto segregation. De facto segregation is, as the Supreme Court has described it, segregation because people like to live with each other of similar, the same race, or because low-income African Americans can't afford to move to middle-class suburbs, or because there's been a history of private discrimination, whether by real estate agents or banks or private individuals, but that these are all non-governmental actions. And when you have non-governmental actions like this that result in segregation, there is no constitutional remedy for it. And in fact, in 2007, as you know, the Supreme Court prohibited school districts from engaging even in the most token racially explicit desegregation plans, because they said that segregation resulted from de facto residential segregation and not from a deliberate public policy. Well, it's a myth, and the reality is that we have a system of de jure residential segregation in this country. Residential segregation that was established by federal, state, and local policy that has never been remedied. Now, you can have a Supreme Court decision that says that school segregation is unconstitutional, and the next year, children can go to integrated schools. But if you decide that residential segregation is unconstitutional, and I'll take a few minutes to demonstrate that it is, you can't desegregate simply by assigning people to different houses the next year. It requires a massive, massive policy of social re-engineering to de-engineer the segregation that we have accomplished. And we've been afraid to attempt that. We've been afraid to confront it. But unless we first familiarize ourselves as a nation with this history that demonstrates that the segregation is unconstitutional, we're never going to have the motivation to undertake the kinds of serious policies that are necessary. So let me just give you a couple of examples of how our metropolitan areas, in very limited time, our metropolitan areas have been desegregated de jure by federal, state, and local policy. I'll focus on two main policies. One is the public housing program. Public housing in this country began in the 1930s for civilians, and it was a housing program for white, middle class, and working class families. It was not a program for poor people. In order to get into public housing, in New York City, for example, a social worker had to visit your home and make sure that you were fully employed, that your children were well behaved, that you had enough good furniture to furnish a public housing apartment. It was a program for working class and middle class families and for whites, not for African Americans. Liberals in the Roosevelt administration in the 1930s, when this started, insisted that some public housing be built for African Americans as well. Not integrated public housing, but segregated public housing. That was the liberal position of the Roosevelt administration in the 1930s. And the public housing program in that period created the outlines of segregated metropolitan areas that we have today, areas that prior to the public housing program were integrated. Because in the 1930s, many metropolitan areas, downtown areas, were integrated because working class families, whether they were African American or Irish immigrants or Jewish immigrants or Eastern European immigrants or rural migrants from rural areas, had to live in the same downtown neighborhoods because they had to be able to walk to work to the factories where they worked. They didn't have cars. And so we had integrated neighborhoods. We paid a lot of attention to Ferguson, Missouri, over the last couple of years. St. Louis is a good example of how the metropolitan area was segregated by this policy. The federal government and the city of St. Louis demolished an integrated neighborhood in downtown St. Louis. They built a public housing project for African Americans only, explicitly. And then they demolished a second integrated area farther south of downtown and built a public housing project for whites only. Well, this went on for a couple of decades. Gradually, over the course of in the 1950s, really, and the white projects started to have large number of vacancies. The black projects had long waiting lists. So eventually, the government turned public housing into a program for African Americans. They opened up the white projects to African Americans. This is what happened in St. Louis. You may remember the Pruitt-Igoe Towers that became a symbol of dysfunctional public housing. The Pruitt Towers were originally built for African Americans, the Igoe Towers for whites. But the Igoe Towers developed large numbers of vacancies, and this happened all over the country. Why did they developed vacancies? They developed vacancies because the federal government had another program. Explicitly, racially explicit as the public housing program, designed to move white families out of urban areas and into single family homes in the suburbs. This really started right after World War I, where some geniuses in the federal government decided that the way to fight communism was to put white families in single family homes, on the theory that if you owned your own home, you couldn't be a communist. But it really got ramped up during the New Deal when the Federal Housing Administration began a program of financing mass production builders, merchant builders, to build entire subdivisions for white families only, explicitly. This wasn't the disparate impact of benign policies. It wasn't that whites chose to live in these FHA-financed suburbs, but blacks didn't. They were explicitly designed for white families only. You're familiar with some of them. Levittown, for example, in New York, which was a giant one for 17,000 families, built in the late 1940s. Pete Seeger used to sing a song written by Malvina Reynolds about ticky-tacky houses on a hillside that all looked the same. That was about a development south of San Francisco. Both of those were underwritten by the Federal Housing Administration on explicit condition that no homes be sold to African Americans. Now, there were many, many other policies. I don't have time to go into them now, but I'd be glad to in discussion later, of the federal, state, and local governments that were designed to segregate metropolitan areas. But let me give you an illustration of how radical it would have to be to fulfill our constitutional obligation to desegregate. Take Levittown, the example I gave you before. In the late 1940s, those homes were built for about $7,000 a piece. Sold for about $7,000 a piece to $10,000. That was about two and a half times national median income at the time, affordable to returning war veterans, to working class families, if they were white. It was about 2.5 times national median income, the equivalent of about $150,000 today. Today, those homes in Levittown, in Daly City, around St. Louis, in every metropolitan area, and here in the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area, financed by the federal government, those homes today sell for $400,000, $500,000, $600,000 a piece. They were affordable to working class families in the 1940s and 50s. Today, they sell for 7 times national median income, not 2 or 2.5 times national median income, unaffordable to working class and African American families. So it's one thing to pass a fair housing law that says, okay, African Americans, you're now permitted to buy into Levittown, which, by the way, is still only 1% black. You're now permitted to buy into Levittown. But that doesn't remedy the unconstitutional segregation of those policies. I'll just give you an example of what it would take to desegregate. If we understood this history, if we understood that this was an unconstitutional system, not just a de facto system, the federal government should buy up homes in Levittown and in Daly City. 15% of the New York metropolitan area is African American. The next 15% of homes that come up for sale in Levittown should be purchased by the federal government for $400,000, $500,000 and resold to working class and middle class African Americans for $150,000. That would be a narrowly targeted constitutional remedy that would desegregate Levittown, desegregate the schools in that community, permit children to thrive. And it's constitutionally required. I've talked about this kind of thing. I'm going to wrap up. I know I'm okay. Out of time. I've talked about this thing to lawyers' groups, to the American Bar Association. No lawyer has ever told me why that is not constitutionally required. What prevents us from doing it is the national consensus that we have de facto segregation, that Levittown, Daly City, and all the other suburbs that surround our metropolitan areas, the white noose that surrounds the African Americans that we have concentrated in public housing. The national consensus is this just happened by accident. And unless we educate ourselves about this history and mobilize a national consensus around the constitutional obligation to undo it, we're never going to make the kind of progress that's necessary in desegregating neighborhoods and therefore in desegregating schools.
Thank you. Again, the hashtag for today is hashtag segregated schools. I would also like to acknowledge that we have visitors here today from the International Visitors Leadership Program from the U.S. Department of State. And so they are, amen. We want to thank you for being here today. Okay, great.